Soft targets, you've heard the phrase. Crowds, sporting events, and even office buildings seem even more vulnerable today. Entry control protection and security are no longer just a concern for the military. Hi, I'm Grant Coffey, and it's our topic today on FLIR Prime. We've got a guest with us today, Ross Harper. I'm glad you're here today with us. He's from FLIR Systems and is a subject matter expert on explosives. We're gonna ask him a few questions today about ECPs. Can you tell me what is an ECP and why is it so important?
An ECP, an entry control checkpoint, is your first line of defense for your property, but more importantly, your personnel. It's also the first impression that your employees, your customers, and the public have of your company or your facility. And so a secure, well-managed entry control checkpoint is really the first step in a strong security impression. An ECP allows you to control who has access to your facility, who you authorize on site, more importantly, who you do not permit on your site. And it allows you to keep out unwanted persons, weapons, or more serious threats such as explosives or radioactive materials.
So what if I want to establish an ECP or an entry control point? Ross, where would I start? What do I do to get that operation going?
Well, the first thing you want to do when establishing an ECP is determine the threat, because the threat is going to help you justify the potential expense of hiring personnel, obtaining new equipment, or developing a secure entry control checkpoint for your facility.
Okay, now you got me interested. How do we go about assessing these kind of threats?
So, to determine your threat, let's start by looking at a low, medium, or even high level threat opportunity. Determining the severity of the potential threat to your facility allows you to determine the justification behind the procedural changes that you might make, or even the programmatic changes, that is, how much money are you willing to or need to spend, and so forth. So when reviewing the threat, you ultimately make the decision, are you going to accept the threat? Are you going to mitigate the threat? Or are you going to take steps to eliminate it?
Wow, it seems like there's a lot of stuff involved with that. I'm not a professional in that area, so what do I do for help or to get things set up? How do I go about finding out about that?
Well, really, your first point of information could be anything as simple as going online or checking with commercial companies that provide security, but also look at municipalities, state, local, and even federal agencies such as Department of Homeland Security. Alternatively, you can also consult a private security professional or company, a third party who specializes in ECPs. Ultimately, you'll always want to involve your local authorities, police, fire, and emergency responders. They will give you local information, crime statistics, historical information on the locality, and they, combined with your other resources, will be able to give you advice on spending money wisely. And from an equipment perspective, you're looking for tried and tested that they can recommend.
That's great stuff, but it sounds like it can get expensive though.
Sure, it can be. But the determination of the severity of your threat will justify the expenditure. If you're looking primarily at a threat of theft or pilferage from an industrial facility, that will be a lower justification versus trying to actively deny somebody bringing explosives or other dangerous materials on site.
You bring up some really good points, Ross. I'm wondering, are there any special considerations for the difference between pedestrians and vehicles?
There sure are differences. And you see, for example, a car or a truck can bring a larger threat package than potentially a pedestrian or individual personnel. When you're screening pedestrian access, it really comes down to how intrusive you want your process to be. If you're screening an individual, you're looking for belongings, backpacks, personal effects. But when it comes to vehicles, you're going to want a dedicated area or screening lane for that, preferably where you can remove the driver from the vehicle and separate the pedestrian from the vehicle at the same time. If you have frequent visitors to your site that are pre-cleared, consider having a designated lane for those with direct access. And that way you can focus your screening and your security on the occasional visitors that do need to be screened in more depth. And also consider screening off the vehicle lane from public view. You want the ability out of sight to increase or decrease the level of screening, the level of investigation of the vehicles based on day-to-day intel if you have threat increase or decrease.
You've talked about a couple different types of screening. I've heard the terms before, and I wonder if you can talk about it a little bit. Active versus passive screening. What's up with that?
Okay, well, active, passive really comes into the level of intrusiveness of the screening. You're looking to find a balance between intrusive screening and convenience at your checkpoint. But an ECP is not about convenience, it's about security. Active screening is when you require physical contact or known, you know you're screening a device, whether that's explosives, handheld trace detection, sampling the inside of a vehicle, somebody's bag or personal belongings, you know you're focused screening on a particular item. Passive screening happens automatically, either without the subject's awareness or in the background. An example for that would be a radiation portal or some form of automated chemical detection running without the subject's knowledge.
That's great information. Do you have any other tips or recommendations that we can cover?
Well, we've said it several times already, but ultimately it's about determining the threat and responding accordingly. Nobody wants to take responsibility for failing to protect their facility when there's countermeasures available. I always want to see a layered approach. If I see a facility that has a single entry control checkpoint or has a single tier of security, you want to consider adding depth to that. Lastly, I always recommend being sure to eliminate any single points of failure, whether that's a single entry control checkpoint, whether that's untrained personnel, or whether that's equipment that you don't know how to use. Consider implementing multiple access, photographic ID, security cameras, and most importantly, training your personnel on the procedures and the equipment to make a successful entry control checkpoint.
Ross, thanks for educating us. It's great information on checkpoint security and ECPs. You can get more information if you want to check it out on our website, flir.com/prime. Thanks for watching another episode of FLIR Prime.